Harper Audio presents Goodly and Grave in a Bad Case of Kidnap by Justine Windsor, read by Laura Kirman.
The Penny Dreadful, Volume 263. Another Missing Child. The Penny regrets to inform its readers that another child, Eddie Robinson, went missing several weeks ago. An artist's impression of the child is shown here, and a full interview with the unfortunate parents can be found on page 2. Zombies. On page 3, the respected scientist, Sir Absalom Balderdash, explains how the recent disappearances may be the work of flesh-eating zombies.
Chapter 1. A Game of Cards. Midnight in Mrs. Milligan's gambling den. Lord Grave puffed on his cigar, blowing smoke into Lucy Goodley's face. She coughed and spluttered, and gave Lord Grave her filthiest stare. He'd be less full of himself once she'd relieved him of all the gold in his pockets.
"Finest cigars in the world,"
Lord Grave said, waving his about.
"You shouldn't smoke in front of me," Lucy said. "It stunts the growth, you know."
A hush fell over Mrs. Milligan's gambling den. Dice stopped rolling, roulette wheels stopped turning, and everyone held their breath. Lord Grave was the most important customer who'd ever visited Mrs. Milligan's. No one else dared complain about his smelly cigar. Lucy's parents, who were sitting at the poker table with Lucy and the eminent lord, stiffened.
"Fair point," said
Lord Grave, and stubbed his cigar out on the coattails of a passing waiter. The waiter bowed, thanked his lordship, and then ran for the kitchens where he sat in a pail of cold water to quench the smouldering embers. Lord Grave turned back to the Goodleys.
"So, you've run out of money. No chance of another game?"
"I'm afraid not, your lordship," said Mrs. Goodley.
She fiddled with the frayed edge of her shawl, which was more fray than shawl. Lucy's mother had a whole cupboard full of very fine shawls at home, but she always wore her frayed one on poker nights. Lucy herself wore a pair of her father's cut-down breeches and a boy's jacket. And unlike most girls, who favoured curls and ringlets, Lucy liked to keep her straight, shiny black hair short. She found it far more practical.
"Nothing left at all to bet with. Come now, you must at least have a house."
"No, sir. We rent a couple of rooms from a Mr. Grimes. We share them with 300 cockroaches, a family of rats and 8 slugs. We're very fortunate."
Mrs. Goodley smiled at Lord Grave in a pathetic way. Lucy shivered at the idea of sharing a room with 300 cockroaches, a family of rats, and 8 slugs. What her mother said wasn't a complete lie. They had once lived in a place like that, but, thanks to Lucy, not anymore. Lucy thought of her large, light, clean bedroom in Leafy Ridge, the Goodley's cottage, deep in the country, hundreds of miles away from London and Mrs. Milligan's gambling den. It was her favourite place in the world. But for the plan to work, the Goodleys had to pretend they still lived in squalor.
"But I do have one thing," said Mrs. Goodley, her voice quivering. Her fingers trembled as she unpinned the brooch fastened lopsidedly to her ragged shawl. It was gold and round, with a red stone in the middle. She placed it on the green cloth of the poker table. Lord Grave picked it up and bit it.
"Real gold, genuine ruby."
"Yes, sir, from my dear departed mother, our little Lucy's grandmother."
Lucy put on her best wan smile and patted her mother's hand.
"But," said Mrs. Goodley, "Mr. Goodley and I, we don't think we have the nerve for another game of poker, sir. Would you consider playing against Lucy instead?"
Lord Grave frowned.
his bushy black eyebrows meeting in the middle. He studied Lucy for a few moments. Lucy sat quite still, letting Lord Grave take a good look at her. She knew what he was thinking, that a 12-year-old girl couldn't possibly beat anyone at poker. But he was wrong, because Lucy never, ever lost a poker game. Unless she lost on purpose.
"This child," said Lord Grave eventually, "not much of a challenge for me."
"Oh, please, sir," said Mrs. Goodley, tears shining in her eyes.
Beneath the poker table, Lucy was pinching her mother's leg hard in order to make her eyes water.
"Otherwise, we'll have to sleep in the gutter tonight."
Lord Grave picked up the ruby brooch and turned it over in his fingers. He nodded.
"Very well."
"Oh, thank you, sir,"
chorused all three Goodleys.
"One moment."
Lord Grave handed the ruby brooch back to Mrs. Goodley.
"I don't want to play for the brooch. I want to play for the girl."
Lucy's stomach dropped down to her toes. This wasn't how things usually proceeded.
"You want to play for my daughter?"
said Mr. Goodley, running his hand through his untidy dark hair.
"I need a new boot girl for Grave Hall. Little Lucy looks just the ticket. If you win, I'll give you that brooch's value 4 times over.
"We'll need time to decide," said Mrs. Goodley,
suddenly sounding much less tearful.
"Don't take too long, or I may change my mind," said Lord Grave.
He got to his feet and strode over to the tiny bar tucked into a corner of the gambling den. The three Goodleys looked at each other.
"We can't," said Mr. Goodley.
"Of course not,"
Mrs. Goodley agreed.
"You know I won't lose," whispered Lucy. "Just think, we'll make enough to live on for years."
"But you do lose sometimes," said Mr. Goodley. "We mustn't risk it."
Lucy wanted to tell him that she only lost a game now and then so people wouldn't be too suspicious, including her parents. But she couldn't. So she shook her head and said,
"Look at him. He's all fuddled with brandy. He's having another glass now."
Lord Grave was leaning against the bar, drinking Mrs. Milligan's most expensive brandy out of a glass practically the size of Lucy's head. Mr. Goodley took both of Lucy's hands in his.
"Dear girl, are you sure?"
"Yes, Father. I won't lose."
Excitement bubbled up in Lucy. Once she'd beaten Lord Grave, she could spend the rest of the summer paddling and fishing in the river near Leafy Ridge and forget about gambling altogether. And although her parents were hopeless in many ways, she loved them very much and enjoyed spending time with them at home. Her father would bake pies. Lucy picked the scorched pastry off before eating the filling. Her mother would get out her toolbox and crash and bang around inside Leafy Ridge, making improvements. Lucy would then quietly pay someone to improve the improvements. It would be the perfect summer. Lord Grave staggered back to the table. All of Mrs. Milligan's customers trailed after him, whispering behind their hands. Some of them had seen Lucy play poker before and were looking forward to watching her win against this stuck-up man.
"Well?"
asked Lord Grave.
"We agree," said Lucy.
"Excellent."
Lord Grave clicked his fingers.
"A fresh deck of cards, if you please. In fact, let's play with 2 decks. Makes for a more interesting game. 5-card draw suit you, young lady?"
Lucy nodded. Mrs. Milligan herself pushed her way to the front of the crowd. She had 2 new packs of cards, which she showed to Lucy and Lord Grave, so they could check the seals were intact. Then she shuffled the cards and began to deal. Lucy's heart thumped with each card that Mrs. Milligan flicked down onto the green cloth.
"No need to be scared," she told herself.
She touched the right sleeve of her jacket. Tucked up inside was a blank card. The card that had changed her life, and that sometimes, when she lay awake in the middle of the night, she feared was the work of the devil. The beautiful woman she'd stolen it from hadn't looked like the devil, though, apart from the fiery eyes burning behind the veil of her hat. Chapter 2. Jumping Jack. When Lucy and Lord Grave both had 5 cards each, Mrs. Milligan placed the rest face down on the table. Then she herded the crowd back.
"Give 'em space," she said. "No funny business."
Lucy picked up her 5 cards, angling them towards her chest so no one could see what they were. 4 tens and the 2 of hearts. The tens were good, but the 2 might be a disaster. A king would be so much better. She'd definitely win with a king. Keeping her gaze fixed steadily on Lord Grave's face, Lucy emptied her mind of everything. The people crowding as close as Mrs. Milligan would allow. The smoke stinging her eyes. The smell of brandy and cigars. Even her parents. She pushed them all from her thoughts until the only thing she saw in her imagination was the 2 of hearts. Then, she imagined the markings on the 2 of hearts melting, like wax on a candle, sliding off the face of the card and down, down into her sleeve, then reforming on the card hidden there. When Lucy had finished imagining with all her might, she looked again at the card she held. 4 tens and 1 blank card. She concentrated even harder. This time, she pictured herself holding the King of Hearts. Colours and patterns began swirling across the surface of the blank card. They gathered into the shape of the heads and shoulders of 2 bearded men. One on the top half of the card, the other upside down at the bottom. Each man wore a golden crown. Lucy's head began to pound, the start of the headache she always suffered when she performed the trick. Her arms ached, the cards feeling like weights, but the trick had worked. The 2 of hearts was safely tucked up her sleeve. Now she was holding 4 tens and the King of Hearts. A winning hand.
"Either of you want to switch?"
asked Mrs. Milligan, indicating the pile of cards in the middle of the table.
"Not me,"
Lord Grave replied.
"Nor me," said Lucy.
"You're both ready to call, then?"
said Mrs. Milligan.
Lucy and Lord Grave nodded. Lucy laid out her 4 tens and her king. At the same time, Lord Grave laid his cards out. Incredibly, he had 4 tens too. But his 5th card was the Jack of Hearts. Kings trump jacks. Lucy had won. She was about to leap from her seat and hug her parents, but before she could move, a strange sensation began to seep through her. It was as though ice was crawling up her arms and legs, freezing her in place. The only thing she could move were her eyes. Everything around her had frozen too. Mrs. Milligan and the rest of the gambling crowd were motionless, their mouths open in mid-shout. Her father's hands were over his face. Her mother's mouth was set in a thin line. Opposite her, Lord Grave sat staring intently at the cards spread out on the table. Then, the strangest thing happened. The heads on the top and bottom of Lord Grave's Jack of Hearts card moved from side to side, as though checking whether anyone was watching. Then, a hand appeared at either side of each of the heads, grabbed the edges of the card, and the 2 jacks pulled themselves up and out of the card onto the table. Lucy blinked in disbelief as the 2 figures ran over to Lucy's King of Hearts, the tiny spurs on their boots jingling. They helped the 2 kings step out of Lucy's card. The jacks bowed to the kings and took their place. Then, the 2 kings marched smartly over to the empty card the jacks had left and climbed into it.
as soon as the Kings had settled into their new card. Lucy's body unfroze, and the crowd around the table started shouting.
Look at that! His lordship's won by a whisker! His king beats the girl's check!
Mrs. Milligan boomed.
Oh, Lucy!
Said Mrs. Goodley, and burst into tears.
He stole it! He stole my card!
Yelled Lucy, leaping furiously to her feet. She flung the Jack of Hearts at Lord Grave and snatched up the King of Hearts.
This was my card!
Lucy, said Mr. Goodley quietly. It won't do any good. He won.
But you must have seen what he did!
Lord Grave stared at Lucy, his bushy eyebrows raised.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.